Magic is a major component of role-playing games and the fantasy genre as a whole. We have all played many different games, as well as watched scores of films and shows, and read the works of various authors, each of which treat magic a bit differently. There are trends at any given time, to be sure, and lately I find myself pondering the way magic has been portrayed throughout our gaming and fantasy culture. Getting right to the heart of my critique, I have taken a critical stance regarding magic over the past couple years. Specifically, I feel magic has lost some of its soul over the past decade or so of gaming. This perspective came gradually, but once I realized what specifically I had been feeling, it hit me like a lightning bolt. To this end, some systems are better, and some are worse. If I had to choose, I would say for me, it was a combination of 4th edition Dungeons & Dragons and video games, especially games such as The Elder Scrolls, Dark Alliance, Diablo, Dragon Age, and World of Warcraft. Now these are all great games in their own ways, and this video is not a critique of any certain game, but it is important that I identify the context from which I am coming. The way magic was treated in games such as these served to illustrate how I do not want to treat magic in my own tabletop role-playing and in my own writing. The style by which magic is handled, I feel, makes it less magical. I do not mean to sound redundant there, but the point I'm making is that magic should feel mystical, fantastical, rare, costly, and beyond ordinary. I will expound upon some of the main problems I have identified. Magic users wield their spells very frequently. At-will spells and constantly replenishing mana gauges are the most extreme examples in this case. Being able to cast fire and ice endlessly is not magical. It is a flamethrower or an energy gun with infinite ammunition. Your character never tires, never gets hurt, and never pays any price for breaking the rules of the natural world. In some systems or subsystems, spell usage or mana levels restore only with a full night's rest. While this limits the risk of absurdity, it is merely a lesser degree of the same issue, and that is, spellcasters can, with only gestures or esoteric phrases, repeatedly defy the laws of the universe. In some tabletop RPGs, certain spells require magical components, which does present the potential for more depth, as your character is having to at least sacrifice something of value in order to obtain a fantastical effect. Unfortunately, the process for obtaining such components is typically of little to no consequence, often as simple as a vague purchase during a brief visit to a local shop. In other subsystems, magic is granted to the mage by means of a patron or an arcane master. A good example here is the warlock from Dungeons & Dragons. Again, we see a spark of storytelling, a possible meaning coming into the picture. However, unless the patron poses a substantial story tie or a complication or a threat to the magic user, he is effectively reduced to a scribble on a character sheet. Nothing more. In other subsystems still, magic has a sort of wild or unpredictable nature. Thus, the caster can never be fully certain what may happen. This chance for a risk or a strange effect is yet another form of deepening. What degree of impact do these wild effects pose? How strange can it get? These are the questions I must ask. This problem becomes compounded when you add multiple magic users into the picture. It sets a precedence that the world contains an unknown quantity of spellcasters who can all potentially be wielding supernatural forces on a regular basis without any consequence to the natural world or reality as it is known to the majority of people. If magic is used frequently and with little or no consequence, it loses the special, wondrous, and dangerous attributes that has defined it throughout history. Magic is quantified with strictly defined parameters. Rather than be mysterious, strange, or capricious, magic in games is typically very straightforward. Your character knows what he knows. He has mastery over his spells. He knows their levels of power, exact procedures, and specific effects. It is predictable, clearly presented, and harmless to he himself. And throughout all of this, the magic is neatly categorized. It is filtered through the perspective and organization of modern Western thinking. Magic is more a science or a spreadsheet than a bizarre, arcane force hidden beyond the ken of mortals. It is clean and sterile rather than gritty and precarious. The character goes from having no ability whatsoever to attempt a given spell to having perfect mastery over it the moment he gains the appropriate level. Such an arrangement is ridiculous, shallow, and boring. Magic should be mystical. It should be exciting, and it should always carry a cost. Casting a spell should feel less like referencing a technical manual and more like invoking otherworldly power. Magic is watered down for the sake of balance. We live in an age of political correctness and pampering. We're taught from birth that fair is always better, and we are indoctrinated to avoid offending anyone or creating any uncomfortable situations. While this lends itself well to modern, privileged societies, it is a far cry from the real world, especially a world with a medieval or ancient setting. Life is not fair, it is rarely pretty, and it is far more brutal than we would like to accept. It would be easy to stray off topic here, so let me bring it back to magic. Why should magic, and characters for that matter, be so balanced and fair? Why should a first level wizard be equally powerful as a first level barbarian? Or in reverse, what warrior could rival a grandmaster spellcaster? Short of having legendary supernatural powers of his own, a swordsman could stand no chance against a mage who wields godlike magic. Instead of having magic that evokes a sense of wonder or dread, we have characters who fire unlimited, medium-power energy rays. A mage's fire spell has the same effectiveness as a warrior's axe or an archer's bow and arrow. The spellcaster almost always has a weaker physical defense in exchange for a more versatile and explosive offense. But he is balanced by game mechanics, such he is overall as potent as anyone else. A more extreme example would be the many combat powers that fill the pages of the player's handbooks of 4th edition Dungeons & Dragons. Consider the following hypothetical examples. Power number 1, Mental Assault. 2d10 plus 5 psychic damage and the target is dazed, save ends. Power number 2, Toxic Infection. 2d10 plus 5 poison damage and the target is dazed, save ends. Power number 3, Strangling Shadow. 2d10 plus 5 necrotic damage and the target is dazed, save ends. Power number 4, Smack to the Head. 2d10 plus 5 damage, target is dazed, save ends. Power number 5, Overwhelmingly Painful Stab. 2d10 plus 5 damage and the target is dazed, save ends. Power number 6, Slash and Intimidating Scream. 2d10 plus 5 damage and the target is dazed, save ends. None of these are any different. They may have different names and flavor texts, but otherwise it is the same effect. Nothing feels special, mystical, or arcane. Let us imagine you can cast this spell once every combat encounter, or perhaps a couple times a day. How is this any different than a character who carries a taser weapon or a gun with stunning bullets? There is no difference. There is no daring, half-crazed sorcerer reaching through the unknowable mists of existence in order to conjure a supernatural force from beyond the mundane world. There is no sacrifice. There is no awe-inspiring moment of majesty. All we have is an unarmored battle droid who shoots tiny plasma beams that gradually sap the enemy of its hit points. And once all is done, the mage is left wanting only to sleep for 8 hours, or in so many current video games, for his energy gauge to automatically replenish on its own. Magic in modern games is mediocre, fair, sterile, predictable, and sadly generic. Exactly all the qualities magic should never possess. Magic is often entirely combat-oriented. Understandably, there would exist war mages, sorcerer mercenaries, hell-bent pyromancers, but what about all the rest of the magic users? What of the tome-collecting scholar, the soothsaying sage, the peaceful wizard hermit, or the just magelord who leads a town? The philosopher wizard, the tinkering artificer. What of all the magic users who are not lovers of bloody battle, who do not involve themselves in fighting the machinations of powerful villains on a frequent basis? Unless someone has a warrior-like spirit, there is far more to life than combat. Dungeons & Dragons, throughout all its editions, notably 3rd and 5th, has offered a refreshing array of non-combat magic. This can range from divination and scrying, to magical transportation and construction, to warding and a curing of ailments. In this fashion, I have held a respect for the game. The drawback is that the game has no inherent system of reward or advancement when it comes to non-combat magic. Your character somehow can never progress without killing things. I must find the notion absurd, that a character's story and his process of personal development takes the backseat, or even backstage, to the act of constantly destroying opponents. In the 4th edition, there came some good strides in gaining experience points for many non-combat endeavors, and I do hope to see 5th edition continue in this vein. If we are to bring magic to life, it must matter in all areas of life, not just the battlefield. Prevalent magic devalues the inhabitants of the world. If so many persons can become laser-firing war machines in cloaks, why aren't more people doing it? If so many wizards exist, and they have libraries, colleges, instructors, academic programs, formulas, and charts and graphs of explaining exactly how magic works, why isn't the whole world operating in a society of magic technology? I recognize that the Eberron campaign setting for D&D has developed this concept, successfully creating a sort of fantasy science fiction, or perhaps fantasy steampunk. While it is not my setting of choice, I find it a more accurate representation of what would actually take place if definitive knowledge of magic existed. However, more important than these thoughts is the following. What is the point of regular people if magic is such a prevalent force? Are peasants and citizens merely stage props? Are they fodder to concoct war stories? Are they contrived victims so that adventurers can have quests to fulfill? Who cares about the struggles, beliefs, and lives of the so-called average people? They cannot machine gun fire miniature lightning bolts, so their stories don't matter. A wizard could just mow them down like ants. To provide an answer to these questions, the regular people of the world do matter. Saving a town has little meaning if you don't know who lives in the town. What is important to them? And what do they do throughout their lives? Likewise, conquering a town of effectively helpless peasants by means of your free, unlimited fireballs is hollow just the same. It would be like taking over a flock of sheep with an infinite supply of grenades. You and I are the regular people in the world. If we don't matter, then nothing else really matters. To frame this from a more general standpoint, our culture's current trend of making everything epic has led to a disconnect from the genuine human experience. Magic itself breaks down much differently when one stops and truly considers the consequences of spellcasters existing in the world. Conversely, in a setting where magic is rare, any magic user who showed his abilities in public would be immediately thronged. Average Joes and Janes would all clamor to learn how to cast spells too. Scholars and scientists would fight one another for the chance to study the mage. Religions would stop at nothing to get the mage on their side as a sort of prophet. Government leaders would turn to this individual, and they would make them into a national icon or an avatar of war. Any of these groups would just as likely have members out to assassinate the magic user. Also, scores would flee in terror or madness from the person. Even more would flock to and follow the mage, as though he were a god made flesh. In all too many games, notably video games, spellcasters go about the world, much to the relative disregard of everyone around them.
That guy just summoned a demonic familiar from a flaming staff. Well, back to tending my pigs.
Look at her over there. She just surrounded herself in a shielding aura of lightning and is levitating through the street. Well, guess I'll go back to stirring this pot of stew.
In MMORPGs, spellcasters run wild throughout the lands, firing non-stop energy blasts, no more meaningful than children chasing each other with water pistols. In the Elder Scrolls games, your character is endlessly casting various spells everywhere he goes in an effort to increase his skill at conjuration or illusion. I realize there is a difference between video games and pen and paper games, but video games permeate our society and our collective viewpoint. We must learn to distinguish that everlasting mana gauges and routine spellcasting are not the marks of a soulful experience. They are better suited to pure entertainment. I should take a moment to comment upon the Dragon Age games. In this series, magic is tightly policed. The mages who go rogue are treated as dangerous criminals. This creates a setting that is ripe for storytelling, and of course, has more sensibility in this regard. The appearance of magic should come with strong reactions from the people who witness it. And if magic was a prevalent force, it would utterly change the world, for better or worse. Magical healing, if overabundant, weakens the story and the characters. Another widespread feature of modern games is the ability to heal with magic, be it magic spells, magic potions, or some other supernatural regeneration. Oftentimes, it is only this access to magical healing that allows the characters to succeed. It makes me wince to admit it, but games have been purposely designed such that the characters have almost exclusive access to healing. Why have villains and intelligent monsters never figured out that they need healers and curative items in order to prevail? There are exceptions, of course, and I must again cite tabletop role-playing games as being more sensible or realistic when it comes to this topic. But throughout my many years of gaming experience, largely from the role of a GM, I see this. The player characters riding the hit point roller coaster, suffering all manner of wounds and in turn receiving a steady supply of healing magic, like a drug addict constantly nipping at the substance he needs. He continuously puts himself through so much suffering just to sate his need for relief. Is he masochistic? Is he a maniac? He is certainly a fiend. I can say this. In my games, the characters are playing for keeps. I do not baby them, and they are not special in the sense that they can defy all reason and heal from the most grievous wounds simply by sleeping one night, nor can they raise the dead back to life as easily as the rules as written would cater. If your life, or the lives of those for whom you care, are not truly on the line, the story is the weaker for it. How many books, films, and mythological tales feature characters who suffer great wounds? Virtually all of them. What about illnesses, curses, and other maladies? The same. Now, nobody wants to get hurt or afflicted, and nobody wants to change. We resist change and hardship. But such is life. If characters cannot become genuinely wounded, maimed, diseased, otherwise hexed, what are they? Are they gods? Are they immortal, indestructible avatars? Why does anything matter if nothing can truly hurt or alter you? If you, the player, are seeking nothing more than entertainment, I can understand the argument that severe injuries would make the game less fun. But if you crave a deeper, more human experience, you must allow for one of the main traits of being a mortal: vulnerability. To understand this better, we must examine how the game is arranged. Is it a game in which your character will run through lengthy gauntlets of combat encounters and objectives to achieve? In this case, debilitation serves as an obstacle to playing the game, yes. Is it more than a game? Is each scene of its own merit? Is each encounter meaningful and a real threat? Then, realistic wounds and healing may be better suited. It comes down to this. Is the game a combat grind, or is it based in storytelling and character development? If magic healing is not rare and limited, the experience is more contrived. Determine if sheer entertainment and convenience are what you value. One could argue that games are played for sheer entertainment value. As such, the system which offers the most gratification and the least inconvenience is the best. When viewed from this angle, it is difficult to make an argument. After all, how do you judge another person's ability to enjoy a recreational activity? Is their version of fun somehow wrong? I believe pure entertainment does have its place, though it should be a limited place. The amount of time and effort I put into my creative works does not allow for such limitation. Pure entertainment should be relegated to endeavors of less consequence. If I'm going to dedicate several hours a week to something, it needs to be more constructive and more meaningful than mere fun. It should be enjoyable overall, without a doubt, very enjoyable and satisfying, but I am not going to bastardize my greatest callings in life. So, if on one end of the spectrum, I have a game of Super Mario Brothers, and on the other end, I have a transformative spiritual quest. Where do my creative projects lie? Writing a book seems much farther into the deep end. A tabletop role-playing campaign perhaps lies somewhere near the middle, and a few hours of Magic the Gathering would be located closer to the light and fun area of the spectrum. Due to the fact that I value a role-playing experience of relative depth and seriousness, I would hate to treat magic carelessly or in a cheap way. Convenience is not the greatest ideal. Elegance, when utilized properly, is a wonderful thing. Diminishing the human spirit just for the sake of convenience is an error I do not wish to make. Pen and paper role-playing is a game, yes, but it is more than a game at the same time. It is human imagination. It is storytelling. It is a creative process. It is a study in other lives. It has the potential for so many substantive elements. Where do I go from here? I have expressed these points and opinions with the intention to stimulate thought. As always, I welcome discussion and I value counterarguments. I understand that my stance may develop with perspectives and information I gain from others. I hope this video has made you think, or in the least, given you some ideas to explore in your own creative games. At this point in time, I'm not entirely sure where I shall go from here. A new edition of D&D and all its wonderful opportunities for fantasy role-playing await, and the majority of character classes automatically gain magic abilities. I will keep moving forward, and I will continue to write, eventually coming to a point along the road where an inn is filled with comrades ready to join me for more adventures. Until then, let us share some ideas in the hope of illuminating the way ahead.